All right. Hi, my name is Tananarive Due. I'm an executive producer of the documentary Horror Noire, A History of Black Horror. I am so excited to sit here with the breakout creator and new face to the horror community, Little Marvin, who serves as the creator, executive producer, writer, and showrunner for Amazon Prime Video's upcoming anthology terror series, Them. We also have joining us Howard Berger, the special makeup effects designer, Deborah Ayorinde, who plays Lucky Emery, Ashley Thomas, who plays Henry Emery, Shahadi Wright Joseph, who's Ruby Lee Emery, Melody Hurd, who plays Gracie Emery, and Alison Pill, who plays Betty Wendell. Before we get into talking about this series, and I can't wait to talk about it, if for some reason you're not familiar with it yet, let's go ahead and check out the teaser.
Like a circle in a spiral, like a wheel within a wheel, never ending or beginning, on an ever spinning wheel. Like a snowball down a mountain, or a carnival balloon, like a carousel that's turning, running rings around the moon. Like a clock whose hands are sweeping past minutes of its face, and the world is like an apple whirling silently in space. Like the circles that you find in the windmills of your.
What you know?
All right, Little Marvin, I am just so excited to talk to you about this show. One of the things I said in Horror Noir is Black history is Black horror. And that is basically right in the wheelhouse of this series, M. So you're showing this insidious side to enduring terror that really lasts for generations. Can you speak about the connections you aim to draw between America and terror with this anthology?
Yeah, very much so. First of all, I'm a huge fan of Horror Noire and you, so thank you for doing this. It's amazing to talk to you. Yeah, terror has been something on my mind for a long time, and specifically the last 4 years, a lot. And I started writing this show about 3 years ago during a summer where I felt like I would never stop waking up to cell phone videos of Black folks being terrorized by the police, with the threat of the police, in public spaces, in stores. And it started to make me think about all the times I've felt terror in my life and about the sort of larger terror of navigating the country in Black skin. And so that's where it began. And it's not a surprise to anyone who knows, public spaces have been weaponized against Black folks since the dawn of this country. But what I hadn't really seen was that tension between the public and the private space, particularly the home. You know, if the world outside is crazy, your neighbors are crazy, your colleagues are crazy, the world is crazy, but here we've got each other, right? In home, we've got each other. And the jumping off point was, well, what if the home turns on you too? And so in that tension, the show began. Yeah.
Well, I know you're a horror fan, obviously. So did you have any horror inspirations when you were making Them, specific titles that, even if Them isn't necessarily like Them, but that have stuck with you and helped serve as inspiration?
A ton. I mean, I'm a humongous fan of 1960s and 70s horror in particular. I would say anything from Rosemary's Baby to Don't Look Now, Repulsion, Carrie. There were so many inspirations. And we actually used that. I from the beginning, we sort of had this goal to create a show about the 50s that felt like it was shot in the 70s. So we were paying homage directly to all of that from Hitchcock on. The thing I would say about it that was super cathartic that I hadn't contended with was that in all of those examples I just used, we're never at the center of those frames. We're the maid, we're the housekeeper, we're the driver, we're the shoeshine boy. And so it was very emotional for me, I have to say. I would sit at the monitor and I would watch this Black family, dark-skinned, beautiful, dazzling, occupying the center of these classic frames. And I would get, like, I would start crying. Like, I'd put on my sunglasses trying to look cool, but, like, truthfully, I was just sobbing at the computer because I realized, you know, as a kid, you don't even know you're being erased subtly by not seeing yourself in the centers of the things you love, you're being erased. So for me, this was a real amazing moment to come back and grab those frames and put folks who looked like us at the center of them. Amazing.
And as a viewer, it also just makes it really, really super scary and personal. I will add that, you know, when that happens.
Goal.
So for the makeup, Howard Berger, in terms of the special makeup effects, tell us about the actual process of bringing these figures to life, the time spent, the kind of makeup, costumes, prosthetics, if you're using any of those. How did you decide what each of these entities would look like, while bearing in mind the historical background of psychology that each entity represents?
Of course. Yeah, I mean, definitely. Obviously, there's going to be stuff in this show if I'm on the show, so that's pretty obvious. But I'm not going to talk about specifics because I want you guys to really be creeped out. But what I got to meet little Marvin. I got the first five scripts and I read them in one sitting and flipped out, and then got to go to a meeting with little Marvin. And the second we met each other, we shared the same brain and we spoke the same language. So it actually was really easy. He could say specific words or references, and either I already worked on those movies
or as a fanboy, I mean, I shit you not, like, sorry, but every movie I've ever loved, Howard had some part in it. He's like, it's like Forrest Gump of horror. He's always there.
So, but it was great. I mean, right away, you know, little Marvin knew what he wanted, you know, and it was, I wouldn't say it was like an easy design period. I mean, because it took a while to figure things out. There's a couple characters that are, you know, prosthetic characters that we really had to find the right, you know, the right look and the right feel and the reason for it. You know, it took a while, even going through certain actors. Sometimes we, you know, did one look on an actor and then we decided we needed to switch actors and go somewhere else with it. You know, it just wasn't there. And I love that. I love the fact that we just kept striving and striving and trying to come up with things that we really had not seen before, things I hadn't done before, which is really exciting. And especially doing a show like this. I mean, listen, I'm a white kid from the San Fernando Valley, you know, and little Marvin brought me into his world and it was really spectacular. And I learned so much and got to work with great actors and you know, but the first, you know, step is doing the design work. So we did a tremendous amount of design work that took a while, and then started doing all the sculptures and mold making and testing and working with our amazing costume designer, Marianne, who's unbelievable. And really, like, we worked together hand in hand. Like, I didn't do anything without dealing with her, consulting with her. I wanted her to take the lead on a lot of things. And I just kind of followed suit. And it's really a great marriage. And that's the thing that was so wonderful about this show, is that we all kind of worked under, or we did, we all worked under one umbrella, which is little Marvin's umbrella, which is really, really a big umbrella. And, you know, be it, you know, figuring out, you know, how Ashley's going to look, or figuring out how this character is going to look, or, I mean, there's so much to this show, and it just keeps going. It keeps upping and upping and upping. And you know, with every script that I kept reading, I'm like, you know, we're going to up this game to the point where it's like, I mean, people are going to not even understand what's going on, you know, and I mean, it's crazy. And little Marvin right out of the gate just said to me, I said, tell me exactly what this is about. And he said, it's about the horror and terror of being Black in America. And I understood it. I completely got it. And what was interesting, I have two children that are Black. And it really helped me see things through their eyes too. And I really used them as a great point of reference through the course of this shoot. I keep calling it a film. It was like a 10-hour movie. It just really was a great experience, and it gave me great opportunity to, you know, and if we brought something to the set and I heard little Marvin laughing, then I knew I succeeded. And then he ran away terrified. So. It was great. It was a great experience.
Hearing him speak, I want to go back and do it again.
It was so fun. Yeah, I was sad when it ended. I mean, you know, because we ended in another location and without everybody here. And I was like, ah, I really miss everybody. Maybe we can do more reshoots or something. I don't know.
No.
No. We're done.
It sounds like there was a lot of laughter. So that's great. So Little Marvin, sound is very important in horror, and so is music. And just from the pilot that I've seen, you know, the music was already a character. So can you talk a little bit about creating an eerie atmosphere through sound and music that really gets that blood pumping in the process of the creating the score for the series?
Yeah, I mean, music for me is everything. It's everything in life. It's also everything in cinema, and specifically in horror cinema. It's very hard to divorce music from great horror. Trying to imagine Jaws without that theme, trying to imagine Psycho without that shriek of strings. It's like it doesn't exist without the two together. And when I was writing the pilot, I blast music. Sorry, neighbors, but I do. I blast music when I'm writing. And I was listening to a lot of old school, like my classic, you know, Christoph Komeda's soundtrack to Rosemary's Baby, or Pino Donaggio's scores to Don't Look Now and Carrie, and everything Bernard Herrmann. So I'm listening to all of this, but like the only modern composer I was listening to was Mark Corvin, whose soundtrack to The Witch is like bar none one of my favorite soundtracks. It's visceral, it's raw, it's terrifying. So I'm blasting that as I'm writing, and then you fast forward a year and a half later and there's Mark Corvin's name on a list, and I was like, what? Like, here's this guy. It's actually like working with Howard. It's like these are these guys who I have admired and respected from afar for like 1,000 years, and then suddenly you're sitting across a table from them and you're making this thing, and it's such a dream come true. But Mark was, first of all, he's just a lovely Canadian gentleman and very sweet and very lovely to collaborate with, but he's also got a crazy mind. And we wanted to pay homage to those classic sort of soundtracks I mentioned, but also shred it through his imagination and his ability to make it very modern. And I think he found a sound that I love. That was the process.
It is fantastic. It is fantastic. And we have the cast here. I can't wait to talk to them too. But before we talk to the amazing cast of the show, let's throw out a clip.
Must be your beautiful daughters.
Yes. This is Ruby Lee. This is Gracie Jean. Girls, say hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Hey, cool to talk.
And these are all yours.
Thank you.
Gracie Jean, be careful now.
It's pretty.
It's a long drive, huh?
Yes. 5 days.
Wow.
Long time.
It was freshly painted.
All right.
And we're gonna get these done.
Okay.
All right.
Come on, girls.
So Deborah, this one is for you. Lucky and Henry are faced with so many challenges, grief, pain, the blatant and not so blatant, although mostly blatant, racism. Horror feels like a really appropriate genre to tell these stories. How did you prepare for the roles and the scares?
Well, as far as the scares, I don't know if there's any way to really prepare for the scares, to be honest with you. You just kind of go through it, and then you kind of purge yourself of the experience when it's all done. But I will say I stayed in Lucky throughout the entire process, even, you know, on days that I was off, even, you know, during the pandemic when we had a pause in filming, I always kept at least one foot in Lucky and didn't release her until we were completely done. But the way I prepared, I would say a main way that I prepared is mainly isolating myself from the people who I love, my family, my friends. Really anyone with whom I would be us, because I really wanted to immerse myself fully in the experience of being them, you know, and being isolated and being alone, you know, and really call on my own experiences of being them. And I couldn't do that, you know, calling and seeing my mom every we, you know, seeing my sisters and things like that. So it was really hard, but it allowed for us on set to create this family, you know, which was really, really beautiful. But yeah, that was the main way that I prepared to play Lucky.
Sounds like you just needed to be uncomfortable, a little bit uncomfortable, no comfort, no safety as much as possible.
Exactly, it was really, really hard, but Lucky required it. She deserved nothing less, nothing less.
You killed Lucky. Okay, well, all of the cast kills it. So let's go to Alison. Alison, from seeing Betty's stoic smile and wave in the clip we just saw, we get the sense that she in human form is just as chilling and dangerous as those supernatural entities. And that really does come across, let me tell you, as a viewer as well. So how did you prepare for this role?
It's what he's like, the stoic smile. I was really interested in exploring how us white women use smiles, politeness, and sort of these quiet voices, femininity, all of these things in this way that is truly dangerous and terrifying, to manipulate perceived weakness, to take pleasure in the weakness of others. So I really came at it from this point of like, how often does she raise her voice? You know, like how often does she not smile? And this is how she's gotten through her life. So I was really interested in that while saying and doing these like shocking, horrible things. And then there was the other side of it. You know, we were just talking about Marianne's costumes, and that was another huge part, just because there was a real process of kind of leaving myself behind, of putting on the layers upon layers, the crinolines and the waist cincture and the garter belt and the thing, you know, like all of those things. And then the wig and the last little bit of lipstick. And I mean, and just, yeah, my husband, when he saw it, was like, you've literally never been whiter. Like, things like, you're so white. Yeah. Yeah. And so just like looking in the mirror at that person became its own preparation. And so grateful to the team, like Marianne and to Howard and to everybody.
Can I give Marianne some flowers too? I just have to say, like, she's not here, but her work in this is one thing to think of a thing, and then Marianne would bring such intentionality to every choice. Like, she'd come up to me and she'd be like, do you know there's a spoiler in that dress? And I'm like, what? I'm doing other things. What are you talking about? And she's like, no, there's a spoiler. Can you see it? And it wouldn't be until I'd look at the dailies and there'd be a sprig of lavender like sewed into a collar or a print in the dress that's a black baby angel. And I'm like, what? Like, she's actually storytelling through her costumes. So it must be called out. She's amazing.
The costumes are really stand out. They take you back, whether you want to be back or not. You are taken back to the past.
We don't. We don't.
So Shahadi, already a fan of your work in the horror space. You're not new to the horror space at all, but can you tell us a little bit about this character, in particular of Ruby Lee, and how she grapples with the campaign of terror against her family?
Yeah, like you said, this is not my first time in horror. This is my second horror project. So I've kind of gotten a little bit more interested in it. Although my parents say that I shouldn't do horror for a minute because they don't want me to just be a horror actor, which makes sense. But for Ruby, let's talk about Ruby. She was such an interesting character to play because she would always stick with me all the time while we were shooting. Like, kind of unconsciously too. Like with Deborah, I know that was like very, very purposeful for you to do, which is incredible, but sometimes she would stick with me and I didn't even realize it. And I would just be acting like her. And it's a really weird feeling, but I love her and I've created this amazing connection to her, and preparing for her was very, very difficult because she basically didn't want much to do with her family and the things that make her who she is. So that was really, really hard for me because I'm the complete opposite. But yeah, I feel like with these characters specifically in the story, they really do stick with you. And that's what my mom was even telling me while we were shooting. I remember there was one time in one of our episodes where we were shooting in this really, really creepy basement. And you could even just like tell the energy was like so thick when you were there. Everybody was kind of like silent. Nobody talked very much. So after set, she like saged me and then like was like, get in the shower right now. So I feel like that's one way that you can kind of just like take yourself away from the character a little bit when you've been working so hard to create this different perspective of yourself. And it's hard. It's been really hard to kind of like separate myself from the character. So yes, but it's most definitely an experience that I'm never going to forget. And it was incredible.
That is hysterical that your mother saged you. I've never heard anybody say that before. That's how you know you're doing it right.
I don't know how to take that, Shahadi. A little offended, but also impressed. I don't know.
Your viewers are going to want to sage the TV when they see an episode. So just prepare for that.
Please.
So Melody, cannot leave you out. What an outstanding young actress you are. You're the youngest of the family. The first one to notice something strange was happening in the basement, of course, because as the youngest, you would notice that. When you first saw Miss Vera on set, how was it being around her? How did you get through filming those scenes with her? Because that's scary.
Her makeup was terrifying and she was like crazy and personal. And she was very tall and kind of scared me a little bit, you know. And one time my baby sister went on set, she was terrified. She was like, ah! She said, no. And I was like, well, it's scary. And it looks so real, so weird. And the basement was very like suspicious. So right outside the basement just told me that this is not a good place to go.
Wow. You're very brave to be doing such scary work and doing it's so young. And as a matter of fact, let's show you how scary it is. Let's check out another scene.
Mama? Mama?
Let me not forget about Ashley Thomas. This is an era when you are in a job where people don't expect to see a Black man. You're an engineer, so you're facing it at home with your family, but you're also facing it at work. And I'm wondering how you prepared for the role and if it pushed any buttons from life while you were working on this.
Yes, certainly. I think how I prepared for the role was like when I'm approaching any character, the first thing I got to do is like strip away my ego. So, and just approach the character with respect. So once those two things are done, then I can start to dive into the character. And you know, my skin's black, I'm a black man. Anywhere I go in the world, I experience the world as a black man. So I'm very aware of that. And there's experiences that I've had growing up in the UK that I can partly extrapolate into the character. But in approaching With No Ego, I had to realize that, you know, I don't know everything. The African-American experience is a unique one. And there was a gap in my understanding. So in order to fully understand the character, I had to speak to my cousins and my close friends that I trusted to help bridge that gap in my understanding and use myself as a vessel to kind of inform Henry's decisions. And then I met someone who just happened to live in my building. He was a man who was born in Texas, and he grew up in the Jim Crow era, and he moved to Chicago. And he was very kind of his time. He sort of spoke to me and shared a lot of his experiences and how he felt and all the things that he sort of went through. And he told me anytime I needed to speak to him to come and talk to him. So he was very helpful and instrumental in me shaping the character. And then I read a book called LA City Limits by Josh Sides. And why that book was very helpful is it spoke about the African-American migration from the Great Depression to the modern day, but it was very specific to Los Angeles. So that just helped me have a real understanding of the time, the era, in a very specific way. And then I used music a lot as well. So I was just listening to a lot of music from that era and just so that I could get into the bones and the feeling of the character. So much so that there was one day that it got too overwhelming for me, actually. I was listening to Sam Cooke, A Change Is Gonna Come, and Deborah would be able to tap into this story. But like, I just started thinking about our people, what they was going through, what they was experiencing, such like violent aggression towards them just for the color of their skin. And I started crying. I just got really upset just thinking about that time. And Deborah actually took care of me on that day and just made sure that I was well looked after. And that was quite early on in the piece, actually. And that sort of like set a precedent to make sure that we were all caring for each other, especially in the Emery family, that we would all look after each other. So all those things helped me to really prepare for the character.
That's beautiful. You know, I can only imagine how immersive it is, you know, because of the costuming and the set design and the cars that it's almost like you are in the 1950s. And I love you bringing up LA because the South gets such a bad rap for the way African Americans were treated, but LA, hey, has its own issues. So, and still does, but certainly did then. That's fantastic. So Little Marvin, it's definitely a series I think people will want to watch with the lights on, and I can't wait for WonderCon and audiences everywhere to check out them when it becomes available April 9th on Amazon Prime Video. Before we close, could you, Little Marvin, tell us if there's anything that you want the audiences to take away from watching this that maybe we haven't talked about already?
Sure. I mean, I think like any artist, your hope is that perhaps the thing that you were able to create and that you were blessed to create sparks some level of curiosity about the world that we live in. And in the case of our show, curiosity around the ways in which we live today. You know, if folks can look at this show and ask themselves, why does it seem like all the white folks live here and all the black and brown folks live here? Is that by chance or is that by design? Spoiler, it's by design, right? Why does it feel like all the great food is here and all the bad food is here? Why does it feel like my house is getting appraised for far less than it should? These are fears and anxieties and insecurities that are based on decades and decades and centuries of disenfranchisement. And so if you're able to come away from the show with a greater understanding that the word segregation is not some name from the distant past, but is in fact part and parcel of the way we live today, there's no greater hope than that for creating the show.
Absolutely, and it's so educational. I mean, even today, a Black family moving into a new neighborhood doesn't know what kind of reception they'll get from the realtor, doesn't know what kind of reception they'll get from their neighbors. So I agree with you.
My neighbors might be listening right now, I don't know.
It is just real. So check out them, which will be premiering on Prime Video. Thank you so much to everybody on this panel. You're all fantastically talented, and I can't wait for more people to see them.
Honored to talk to you. Thank you. And thank you, WonderCon.
Thank you, WonderCon. Thank you.